Welcome to the Bamboo Podcast, where we chat to a range of guests on self-care, infant care, and relationships. We are your hosts, Kaila
and Leah.
In today's episode, we hear from Dr. Madeline Sprajcer. Dr. Sprajcer is a psychology lecturer at Central Queensland University in Australia. Some of her research interests include sleep psychology in vulnerable populations, the impact of on-call work, and managing workplace fatigue in safety-critical industries.
Madeline and her partner welcomed a baby about a year ago, and in this episode, she talks to us about the common and lesser known impacts of poor sleep quality and provides practical strategies for how new parents can optimize their sleep routine during the challenging postpartum period. Enjoy. Well, welcome, Maddie. I'm so excited to talk to you today about sleep. Really want to just get some ideas on how mums can support themselves to improve their sleep, as we know that there's a lot of mothers out there that are very sleep deprived. Could you please explain the different types of sleep disturbances that we can experience?
Yeah, of course. And again, yeah, thank you so much for having me. There's a whole range of different types of sleep disturbance that we can experience. So I guess thinking about new mums in particular, a lot of what we sort of hear about and think about is reductions in the sleep duration, so the amount of sleep someone's actually getting. And that's a really big way that sleep can be disrupted. So, you know, for new mums, obviously, who are tending to an infant overnight, you might not be getting as much sleep. But, you know, there's a whole range of other people in the population who are not getting enough sleep as well. But that's not the only problem that we can have with our sleep. So in addition to the amount of sleep you're getting, the quality of sleep that you get is also really important as well. So sleep is made up of different stages. So there's light sleep, there's deep sleep, and there's what we call rapid eye movement sleep, which is dreaming sleep. And so essentially your sleep quality, to sort of simplify it a little bit, is sort of made up of different amounts of those different types of sleep. And so if you're, you know, a new mum and your sleep's constantly getting disrupted, the amount and distribution of those sleep stages can be impacted as well. So you might not be, for example, getting as much deep sleep, which can be really problematic for, you know, that's the sort of restorative value of sleep. And that really leads into the issues with broken sleep. So with new mums, if you're getting up to tend to an infant overnight, your sleep's obviously going to be broken probably a couple of times overnight, at least in those, you know, few early weeks and months. And that can really impact your sleep quality and the restorative value that you're getting from that sleep. And for new mums as well, a lot of the issues with sleep that we see are because people are trying to be awake at times when really their body's designed to be asleep. So our bodies essentially function on something called a circadian rhythm, which is essentially across the 24-hour period. It's this rhythmic nature of our sleep and wake cycle. So, you know, we're awake during the day, asleep at night, typically. But when you've got a baby, often you're trying to be awake during the night at various points and sort of redistributing the sleep that you're getting across that 24-hour period. You know, maybe you're getting some sleep during the day, trying to catch up and awake during the night. And that can be really problematic for sleep quality as well.
It's really interesting. I found it really interesting. I was reading one of your articles and you were reporting on some studies that actually said that some, you know, new mums do actually get sufficient amount of sleep, right? But it's all of those other aspects. So I think we often think of it as, yeah, just that reduction in sleep, that's the issue, but they might still be getting, you know, 7 or 8 hours, but it is, you know, spread throughout that day or really broken up throughout the night.
Yeah, and that's really what can be problematic from a quality perspective. You know, if you're constantly waking up and then going back to sleep, you're not really getting any of that really deep, lovely restorative sleep, because when we fall asleep, we go through light stages of sleep before we get to deep sleep. And so there's some theorizing that, you know, if you're getting broken sleep across the night and, you know, even into the day, you're spending more time in the lighter stages of sleep potentially, because you're essentially going into sleep over and over again rather than just getting a nice big block of restorative deep sleep.
Yeah. And what are some of those impacts on the mother's body, for instance, if they're not getting that restorative sleep?
Yeah, so there are so many effects of not getting enough good quality sleep. You know, the first is really just those feelings of fatigue, which I'm sure any new mum is familiar with. You know, my wife and I had a baby about a year ago, and the feelings of fatigue in those first few months, you know, the fatigue is real. So, you know, that's obviously something that you're going to immediately be aware of when you're not getting enough sleep. But in addition to just those feelings of fatigue, you're also going to see real problems with cognitive functioning potentially. So things like your memory or reaction time or just ability to kind of reason through complex tasks, we see that that's really impacted as well. For new mums, one of the problems we see as well is issues with mental health. So if you're not getting enough good sleep on a regular basis, that's where we start to see a relationship between, you know, poor sleep and mental health outcomes like depression and anxiety. You know, one night of not getting a good sleep, like sure, we all have that, you know, even outside of parenting, you're not going to see any massive effects on mental health from one night if the rest of the time you're sleeping pretty well. But if you're regularly not getting enough good sleep, you know, every night your sleep's disrupted, that's where we start to see that relationship between, you know, those mental health outcomes and sleep. It's not just mental health though, we also do see physical health effects too. And again, this is more on the sort of long-term side of things. You're not seeing these on a day-to-day basis necessarily. But if you're not getting enough good quality sleep regularly, you know, year on year, that's where we start to see an increased risk of various health problems too. So anything from an increase in cardiovascular disease risk, an increased risk of gastrointestinal disorders, diabetes, all these kinds of health outcomes are potentially affected by how much sleep you're getting too.
I suppose it's also important to mention that, you know, you might have a baby that sleeps really well and it is just that initial few months that's really challenging, but that's not always the case. And that could be going into a year or even beyond that. Being mindful of that would be really important for new mums, that it's, there might not be sort of that end date that they're anticipating.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. And I mean, I think so much of it depends on, I don't know, like the luck of the draw, really. Like from what I understand, you know, some babies, they just come out and they're pretty good sleepers, you know, from the get-go. But other babies, it's a totally different experience. Like I think me and my wife just got really lucky with our baby. And, you know, he's been a pretty good sleeper, aside from the first couple of months, which were pretty rough. to say the least. But yeah, like I think that's a totally different experience to so many parents who are having, you know, trouble with not getting enough sleep for years and years. You know, there's some evidence out there saying that your sleep doesn't actually go back to normal, you know, inverted commas, whatever normal is, until your baby is 6 years old. So wow. Potentially a really long-term effect of, you know, broken sleep, you know, even if they're not waking up to feed or, you know, nappy changes or whatever overnight, you know, 4 or 5 year olds, they're still waking up overnight and needing their parents too. So it's not just a newborn thing.
That's right. They do wake up, and that kind of makes me think about co-sleeping. Potentially, you know, in those very early days, you've got the little ones waking you up to be feeding. But what happens for those mothers that have toddlers that tend to walk through and jump into their beds through the night? Like, how does that impact their sleep?
Yeah, co-sleeping is a really interesting one. And when we look at the research, though, looking at how co-sleeping can impact a mum's sleep or parent's sleep, it's actually a really mixed bag. And interestingly, the research doesn't often differentiate between infant co-sleeping and toddler co-sleeping. They're kind of lumped in together typically. So essentially what we've seen in the literature is that some evidence says that if you're co-sleeping, your sleep is more likely to be disrupted, which like kind of makes sense, right? You've got a baby or a toddler in the bed with you, they're making noises, they're rolling over, that's potentially waking you up. And also for those mums, we actually see, particularly with co-sleeping with an infant, that mums are actually experiencing more what we call nighttime arousals when they're sharing a bed with their baby. And so, you know, that makes sense from a sort of an evolutionary standpoint, right? Like you're waking up or you're more easily woken to attend to the needs of your infant, which is great from, you know, sort of a safety perspective and an infant care perspective. But that does mean that you are experiencing all of those arousals during the night. So sort of small awakenings, which can impact your sleep quality as well. It's really interesting, though, because the literature isn't all on one side of the fence or the other. So some evidence says that co-sleeping can actually be really great for maternal sleep quality, particularly for mums who are breastfeeding. You know, and a lot of that's probably associated with the fact that, okay, if the infant needs to feed, you're not having to get out of bed, make a bottle, come back, or all that kind of stuff. So there's evidence saying that co-sleeping can be really beneficial for maternal sleep under those circumstances. But yeah, just a really mixed bag, really.
And so we probably want to know, like, how can we make it better? How can we improve our sleep as mothers?
unfortunately, there's not really a one size fits all answer for that question. You know, I wish there was. That would, you know, that would be really great for everybody. Essentially, it's about what figuring out what works for you. So is your baby or is your toddler or, you know, child even allowing you to get that sleep when they're in bed with you? Are they getting enough sleep when they're in bed with you, or are they getting better sleep when they're in their own bed, you know, in your room, a different room, all these kinds of things? You know, like for me, I wanted to do co-sleeping. I was into it, thinking, oh yeah, like you say, it'd be nice to be able to bring them into bed with me in the morning and that kind of stuff. But our baby was having none of it. Like I would try, like, oh, okay, it's 5 a.m. Maybe if you come in bed with us, you'll go back to sleep and we can all get a bit more sleep. But the second he's in our bed, he's like, nah, it's playtime. Yeah. There's no relaxing when you're in your mum's bed.
You've been doing some research on mums and how their lack of sleep can impact their driving. Would you be able to tell us more about that?
Of course. You know, this is an area that's really dear to my heart, because I think, you know, when we think about safety, often all we think about is, you know, workplace safety and health and safety, all these kinds of things that are outside of sort of the domain of new parents. But I think it's really important to just be aware that, you know, new mums and new dads are often undertaking what's essentially a really safety critical task, and that's driving. And they're potentially doing that while really significantly fatigued. You know, in the workplace, there are all these strategies and systems and, you know, even legislation around making sure people are safe on the road. But, you know, there's no legislation around new parents and driving. So I guess I'd just like to make sure that new mums are aware that you just need to think about whether you're safe to get behind the wheel when you're about to drive, particularly with your infant in the car, because we do see these really significant decrements to cognitive performance, driving performance in new mums. And, you know, that's because of all the sleep issues we've been talking about. So if you're not getting enough sleep, or your sleep quality is really poor, that can really affect your ability to operate a car safely. And that's not only things like reaction times and, you know, situational awareness, but it's also potentially having a micro sleep while you're driving. And that's the real trouble with fatigue and driving. So for those of you who don't know, a micro sleep is just a really short, inadvertent period of sleep. And it can happen without warning when you're really fatigued. So essentially it's falling asleep while you're driving for anywhere from, you know, a couple of seconds to even a couple of minutes. And if you're driving at, you know, 50, 60, 100 Ks an hour, that can be, you know, 50, 100 meters that your car's traveling without you actually being in control of it. So I'd just really encourage new mums to just be aware of that potential risk, and making sure that being aware of when you need to drive and making decisions about that, I guess, from an informed way. You know, for example, if you know you have to take your baby to an appointment in the morning, you know it's going to be a bit of a long drive, then perhaps your partner could be the one to look after the baby during the overnight wakes to make sure that you're fully rested for that drive you need to do. And thinking about scheduling your drives at times when you might not be as tired. So driving, you know, kind of between 8, 10, 11 a.m., that's sort of when most people are at their most alert. But if you're driving at 2, 3, 4 in the afternoon, that's when most people are feeling fatigued during the day. And if you know you're not sleeping well, try to do your driving earlier in the morning if you can, to avoid the risk period in the afternoon or, you know, late in the evening.
And we've all felt fatigued, but what are some of those warning signs, I suppose, when you want to maybe take a step back and think, I shouldn't be driving?
It's a difficult one, because everyone's signs and symptoms of fatigue can be a little bit different. It seems that when you've had 5 hours sleep or less, we see an approximate doubling of the risk of a vehicle crash. And that's about the same risk that we see at a 0.05 blood alcohol concentration. Wow. So if you've had 4 hours sleep the night before, that's actually putting yourself at a really significant risk of a crash. So as a first kind of rule of thumb, try to avoid driving if you haven't had at least 5 hours sleep in the previous 24 hours. But then on top of that, just being aware of your own signs and symptoms of fatigue. So if you're feeling really groggy, if you're feeling really forgetful, really cranky, if you keep yawning, if you've got, you know, keep rubbing your eyes, all those kinds of symptoms of fatigue, that's when you need to start thinking, okay, well, do I need to get behind the wheel of a car? Because the unfortunate thing about a micro sleep is that that's not necessarily going to be preceded by anything. Like if you're just feeling fatigued, generally you get behind the wheel, maybe you're driving for half an hour, there's no immediate early warning signs that you're going to have a micro sleep. that can just happen totally without warning while you're driving. So you want to sort of be making the decision based on the evidence about how you're feeling and how much sleep you've had before you get behind the wheel.
Maddie, a portion of your research relates to shift workers and industries where sleep is likely to be impacted. So, for example, firefighters and the transport and aviation industries. As part of that, you look at proactive and reactive measures. So ways to preemptively reduce fatigue, as well as then managing the impacts of fatigue when it does impact workers' ability to work safely. Which made me think, what can mums do to help before they feel fatigued? So thinking about that bedtime routine, and then when they're already feeling fatigued. So do you recommend that mums take naps, or is it better for them to just push through until bedtime?
You know, I really love that. I think that's a really great way to think about it. And yeah, as you say, I do a lot of work with industry. So yeah, I guess applying that to new mums does make sense, thinking about it in that sort of proactive and reactive way. So like you say, before bed, you know, the really key thing is setting yourself up for success with your sleep environment. So with sleep, we have something called sleep hygiene that we talk about a lot, which isn't designed for new mums specifically, but does apply to this situation as it does with, you know, shift workers or anyone else who's trying to get sleep essentially under difficult circumstances, or, you know, even under perfect conditions. There's always things you can do to improve your sleep environment and your behaviors around sleep. For example, making sure your room is nice and dark. That's a really good strategy, particularly if you're trying to get sleep at times when your body isn't really expecting to sleep. So if you're, you know, you put your baby down for a nap in the morning once it's light outside and you're trying to get an extra half hour of sleep while they have a sleep, that's the type of situation where it's really important to make sure your room's nice and dark, because otherwise that light is essentially going to have an alerting effect on your body and it's going to be harder to catch up on that sleep. But even, you know, even before bed in the evenings, making sure your room's nice and dark, also nice and quiet and a good temperature. You know, we typically say between sort of 18 to 22 degrees is ideal for most people to have the best chance of getting a good sleep. But also, if you think about what parents are normally recommended to help with their infant's sleep, often what's recommended is a routine. So, you know, for a baby, you might read them a book, brush their teeth, and then they go to bed. So, and you do that same thing every night, and it kind of gets their brain to know, okay, well, it's time for sleep. We're getting ready to go to sleep. The same thing actually also applies for us as adults. So before bed, it's really important to try to do the same thing every night, just like your baby or your child, maybe brush your teeth, put the dishes away, get in your pajamas, and then read a book for 10 minutes. Whatever it is, if you're doing the same thing before bed every night, that's kind of getting you into this routine of, okay, being able to go to sleep a bit more easily, and then also having a better quality of sleep as well.
It's really beneficial, like just the things that, because you do, I remember in those really early days, really protecting that kind of like, have a bath, read a book, like to get this child to go to sleep, but also applying that to yourself and the routine that you're going to have so that you can promote your sleep. I was thinking around the, like it's obviously beneficial then for mums to have naps during the day if they can, but some mums report like just not being able to nap. They were never nappers and they can't have naps during the day. But I was wondering, would it help if they just sat down and closed their eyes? Like they might not have an actual nap in bed, but what sort of things can they do to still kind of refresh themselves and to support their sleep maybe later on in the day?
What I would probably recommend is trying to work with your body's natural circadian rhythms rather than against it. So if you're trying to nap and it's say 11 a.m., you know, maybe that's when your baby goes down for a nap. That's when my baby's going down for a nap at the moment. So we'll just use that as an example. If I were to go and try to have a nap at that exact time, my body is basically telling me, no, it's time to be awake. I don't have the right body processes going on to tell my body that it's time for sleep. So what I would suggest is try to have a nap at times when your body is most likely to actually allow you to have that nap. So for most people, that's sort of in that sort of early to mid-afternoon period. So 2 p.m., 3 p.m., maybe 4 p.m.-ish, going and laying down in a dark, quiet room, you know, maybe put an eye mask on, maybe put some white noise on, you know, even we do that for infants, no reason we can't do it for ourselves too. And just putting yourself in that optimum sleep environment at a time when your body is designed for sleep, it both gives you the best opportunity for actually getting a nap in, even if you don't typically consider yourself a napper. You put yourself in that optimum environment, it's possible you're going to fall asleep. But on top of that, it's giving you a break and a bit of time for relaxation. You know, even, you know, a bit of meditation or something like that can have really restorative effects. It's not necessarily going to make you feel less fatigued, but it's certainly going to help you in other ways. So I guess just giving yourself that time as much as you can, whether you're asleep or not, rather than, you know, doing chores or scrolling on your phone, as tempting as both of those things are.
And I would think also just taking yourself to, you know, that sort of relaxing area at your bedroom. If you're just lying on the couch watching some TV, you're probably noticing toys on the floor and maybe you can see the kitchen and dishes in the sink. So I assume that also has a big impact on making that a relaxing, safe environment to sleep.
Well, that's exactly right. And, you know, I think there's a real temptation of when your baby's asleep, you've got to get all the things done that you can't or that are difficult to do when they're awake. And, you know, like, I totally get it. It makes total sense. And, I was doing the same thing too when we had a newborn. But eventually I realized that, no, if there's an opportunity where I might be able to have a nap to be able to catch up on even a little bit of sleep, it's actually going to be more beneficial for me and the baby to actually have that sleep rather than to, you know, do the dishes. Like, the dishes can wait. You know, as much of a, I guess, as a cliche as that is to say, but, you know, sleep is just so important for so many aspects of our functioning that really prioritizing sleep is really critical. And, you know, the same thing is true, you know, even going to bed at night, like procrastinating bedtime and trying to, you know, get other stuff done rather than getting sleep. You know, obviously making sure you have clean clothes and clean dishes is important, but, you know, getting sleep, it just is so critical for so many aspects of our functioning that I'd really just encourage you to just try to make it a priority.
I love that. And that you mentioned as well, that it's so important for the baby as well. So maybe you can tell us a little bit more about the importance of being rested and, you know, getting that good quality sleep on our attachment with the infant, also with our partners. So it's a really tricky time for not only the mum who's given birth, but the partner as well, and that sleep I'm sure is also broken.
You know, I feel like the relationship between relationships and sleep is so interesting, and particularly in that sort of romantic relationship context, and, you know, in an environment where you've just had a new baby, or, you know, maybe you've got a 6-month or a 12-month old, it's such a new phase of your relationship that maybe you haven't experienced anything like that before with your partner. It can be quite a stressful time for anyone, but also we know that sleep is closely linked with that relationship. It's interesting though, we don't know if there's really a causal effect there or if it's just an association. So there is this evidence that says, okay, people who are in more secure romantic relationships with their partner do tend to have better sleep. But is one causing the other? What is the relationship there? Or is there a third factor that's maybe interacting with both? We don't actually really know. It does make sense, right? Like, if you and your partner are getting along really well, you probably don't have worries or anxieties or whatever when you're going to sleep, which might help you sleep better. But then also, if you're getting, if, you know, maybe you're getting really bad sleep, maybe you have insomnia or maybe another sleep disorder or something, that's obviously going to impact your daytime functioning. And in addition to, you know, the potential cognitive effects of not getting enough sleep, we know that not getting enough sleep is going to make you more irritable. It's going to affect your mood, and that can all really affect that attachment that you have with your partner. We did a study recently looking at something called chronotypes. And so chronotypes is really whether you're like an early morning person or you're an evening person, or some people are just kind of in the middle. We usually refer to morning people as larks and evening people as owls. So put a bit of context around that. And we know that even being in a relationship with someone of a different chronotype to you, that can impact your sleep and also how satisfied you are in that relationship. So if you're in a relationship with someone who wants to be awake when you want to be asleep and vice versa, that can, you know, potentially cause some problems in the relationship. So it does seem like there's quite a, there is a relationship between your relationship and your sleep. I guess thinking about it from the infant side of things, there also does seem to be a relationship between the degree of bonding with the mum and the baby, and how well they're sleeping. And again, this isn't necessarily a causal thing. We're not sure how those two things really relate to each other, but it does seem that, you know, mums who aren't sleeping so well, maybe they have insomnia, maybe their sleep is really disrupted, We do tend to see that they don't have as strong of a bond with their baby as mums who have really good quality sleep comparatively. But again, it could be that there are other factors that are affecting both of those things. So, you know, for example, mental health, that could potentially be something that's both impacted by sleep, impacts sleep, and then can also impact the degree of bonding. So it's quite a complex relationship potentially that we're seeing between sleep and bonding. So it's not to say if your infant sleeps badly and you sleep badly, you're not going to be bonded to them. Far from it. It's just that when you tend to have one problem, it can be related to a number of different factors, but we do see that there is that bit of a relationship there. There are some studies saying that even if you control for, say, maternal depression, that there is still that relationship between maternal sleep and infant mother bonding though. So I guess it's just telling us really that anything we can do to improve both our sleep and our infant sleep is only going to help things.
Very interesting. I feel like my partner and I are not quite aligned. I'm definitely more of an owl and he's more of a lark, but we're managing it.
Yeah, my wife is definitely an owl and I'm probably a neutral type, but she's like a real owl. But ever since having a baby, it's a lot harder to be an owl because you got to go to sleep early if you're going to get enough sleep before your baby wakes up in the morning.
Yeah, that's interesting too. I suppose that would change for a lot of people with having an infant around, that maybe they were very set in having late nights, but now they have to adapt, and that probably makes it a lot trickier to get that quality sleep as well.
Well, that's it. Yeah, if your body is naturally programmed to want to be up late at night, it can be really hard to go to bed early. You know, you've got biology working against you essentially. And, you know, you can, what we call entrain yourself. You know, if you wake up early every morning, that's kind of keeping your circadian rhythm in check a little bit. Anyone who has kids will know your baby or your child is going to wake you up pretty much at the same time, pretty much every morning, which is kind of good for keeping you entrained. But it does mean that if you're unable to go to sleep before, say, like 11 p.m. or midnight, and you're still getting woken up at 6:30 every morning, then over the long term, you're potentially seeing a lot of sleep loss, even though maybe your sleep isn't necessarily disrupted anymore.
And what about when people do get woken through the night? Like, what would be some ways that they could help themselves get back to sleep? Because obviously through the night it is dark, but I often hear mums speaking to me about, you know, they'll get up to feed and then their brain turns on and they start to think about all the things they still need to do, or they start thinking about things they hadn't done that day or other stresses in their life. But how can they support themselves to then go back into that good sleep?
It's a really tricky one. And, you know, I think a lot of people do struggle with that, particularly in those first early months where everything seems much more stressful than, you know, maybe awake when your baby is one is going to be pretty different to awake when your baby is like 2 weeks old. It's, you know, apples and oranges really. But I guess thinking about getting back to sleep as the goal. So both trying to keep those wake periods as short as you can, and then trying to get back to sleep as fast as you can. And I think like my number one strategy for that is making sure you're not turning any big lights on. Because we know that exposure to light, really any light, essentially goes through your eyes and tells your brain that now it's time to be awake. So if you wake up at 3 a.m. to tend to your baby and you're turning on the lights in the house, that's essentially telling your body, all right, it's time to be awake now. And your body's going into that sort of more alert, like just level of alertness, really. And so then when you try to go back to sleep after tending to the infant, you've already woken up to a degree that you maybe wouldn't have if you kept the lights really low. Like, I know for myself, if I have to wake up to my son in the night nowadays, I don't turn any lights on. I just turn the little light on my phone on and I point it at the ground so that it's not pointing at my eyes and not pointing at his eyes, because I find that that level of light is actually more dim than actually even any of the lamps in my house. Of course, if you have like a nightlight, that's a bit better than using your phone light. That's obviously going to be a better strategy, but I don't have that, so I'm just making do with the lowest level of light possible.
I was going to say I love that, because you're also not wanting to wake yourself, but then you mentioned, you know, we're also not wanting to wake him.
Yeah, exactly. You know, the more alert he gets during the night, the harder it is for him to get back to sleep, and then the harder it is for me to get back to sleep as well. And we want to avoid that as much as possible.
Is it then also important to try and just stay focused on that single task and not kind of get distracted.
Yeah, absolutely. And really anything else you're doing as well is lengthening the amount of time that you're awake, which you want to minimize that as much as you can, not only from a, you know, ease of going back to sleep, but also you want to just try to maximize the amount of time you have available for sleep, like what we call the sleep opportunity. Because if you're then staying up and tidying a few things or whatever in the middle of the night, that's eating into the time you have available for sleep, because ultimately your baby's going to wake you up at whatever time they're going to wake you up anyway. So you want to avoid eating into that possible time that you have, and also avoiding things like looking at your phone. I know I just said I use the phone light, but that's without the screen on. But looking at your phone, it's essentially sending those same awake and bright signals to your brain. Because of the type of light that's emitted from those phones, it can impact your alertness as well. So trying to avoid using your phone during any of those overnight wakes can be really good as well. And if you are using it to track feeds and using it for that, put it on like night mode, which I think avoids, I think it's like an orangey or always ready color on some phones, but it eliminates essentially blue wavelengths of light, which we know that those types of wavelengths can affect your alertness more than the red wavelengths. So if you have it on night mode and with the brightness dimmed, you can try to minimize those effects as much as possible. But yeah, really just try to avoid using a phone during those overnight wakes is the best advice.
Thank you so much for joining us today. I guess we just wanted to ask, you've provided heaps of excellent advice, but if you just had a single takeaway for new mums who are just, you know, starting to feel that fatigue set in, what would the little takeaway be for them?
I guess my key takeaway would be to share the load as much as you can. And I don't just mean between partners, but also grandparents, friends, anyone who's offering to help you with whatever. I would just encourage you to take up the help where you can. Anything that you can sort of shift or share the load with to give yourself more opportunity for sleep, that can only be a good thing. My wife and I, when our son was young, we would each have 6-hour blocks of uninterrupted sleep each night. You know, I would go to bed early and then she would look after the baby, or, you know, wake up, she would be responsible for any wakes, and then I would do the second part of the night. And it just meant that we were both happier, more well rested during the day, and just sharing the load a little bit more. It was really helpful.
And also pointing out how important sleep is, like really prioritizing that sleep, that you both then get good sleep instead of one person not getting as much sleep as the other person. I really like that idea.
Yeah, I think it's really tempting to think, oh, well, you know, maybe one partner's back at work, so they need to be getting a full uninterrupted night of sleep every single night. And, you know, like particularly depending on what job you have, if you're driving to work or you're doing a job that's, you know, really important that you're alert from like a safety perspective, obviously you need to be doing all you can to be getting enough sleep so that you're, you know, safe to drive or safe to do your work when you get there. But also just, I guess, being intentional about that division of labor during the overnight period and making sure that you are kind of optimizing it as much as you can. Like I know for me and my wife takes every opportunity to have a nap during the day because she like being home with my son, whereas, you know, I was working, so I was unable to have that same opportunity. So that informed the decisions we would make about overnight sleep. Didn't mean that I wasn't doing any overnight stuff, like I still was, but it was about the timing of my overnight wakes to make sure that I was okay in the morning without needing that nap. So just, it's really just about figuring out what's going to work for you and your family, essentially, as with all things with parenting, I guess.
Yeah, I love that emphasis though on sharing the load regardless of who's working at which point. I think that's really, really important.
Yeah, I agree.
Well, thanks again. Thank you so much for joining us. That was extremely informative.
I definitely think people are going to get some really good tips out of that. That's really helpful. Thanks so much, Maddie.